Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? Well, we're losing Saturn over in the evening sky, and we have lots of planets over in the morning sky with Jupiter, Mars, Venus, and even Mercury coming up there later on this week, reaching greatest western elongation. However, that leaves us with not a lot to see over in the western sky unless you really catch Saturn there right before it dips below the horizon, before the sky gets dark. That only leaves us with the gas giant planets that are way out there, Uranus and Neptune. And I already talked about Neptune a couple weeks back being in opposition. And this week, we can actually find Uranus at opposition because it will have reached opposition on Monday, October 12th. And it's actually pretty easy to find, despite the fact that it's in a really, really dim constellation. But we're going to actually start in another constellation to get there. So if we look overhead in the evening sky, we've got Vega and Deneb and Altair of the Summer Triangle, somewhat over towards the western portion of the sky if we're looking at about 9:30 in the evening from approximately 40 degrees north latitude, give or take 10 degrees north or south of there. We also are going to have Fomalhaut down here towards the south. And over in the west, we've got the Great Square of Pegasus here, Andromeda coming up this direction out towards Perseus and Cassiopeia towards the north. But what we're going to do is actually focus more towards the east. You'll notice there's a couple of stars right here below where Andromeda is. Andromeda comes down this way off the Great Square of Pegasus. And this star is Hamal, which is Alpha Orionis of Aries the Ram, and there's another star right nearby called Sheraton, which is Beta Orionis. And we're going to use those stars to jump over into Pisces, which is where Uranus is. So what you'll want to do is ideally have binoculars like these. 7x50s are ideal because they've got a nice big lens of 50 millimeters. They'll magnify by 7 times, making them easy to handhold. What you really don't want to use is something like this, even though it provides more magnification. The lenses on these are really small, and so you're not going to be able to see much. So do try to use either 7x35s, 8x40s, or 7x50s, or even 10x50 binoculars to do this. We zoom in on this area, and you can actually see Uranus does pop up over here. So here is where Aries is, and if we look at how these constellations' lines look, you can see how Aries kind of goes out this way, and Pisces sort of forms this V shape of really dim stars. These are mostly fourth magnitude stars. But, conveniently, the stars here in Aries point pretty close to where Uranus is at. So how can we find that? I'm going to show you the star hop, actually, if you were using binoculars without any of these convenient lines and saying, oh gosh, I know exactly where I'm going because look, there's Uranus right there. We'll actually do this so that you'll know how to do this particular star hop on your own. So we start here at Hamal, which is a second magnitude star. You can see that from just about anywhere. When we bring that in with a binocular field of view, see we've got about 7 degrees field of view here. We can center that with Sheraton, and we've got both of these stars in there, no problem, in a nice wide field of view. So if we head from the brighter star to the dimmer one, and then off towards where we want to go to see Uranus, we're going to lose Hamal on the outer edge, and as we move past Sheraton, we're also going to lose it. But on our way, we're actually going to have this star, which is just outside where we would lose Sheraton, and then we would gain this star, which is Eta Piscium, and it's a 3.8 magnitude star. So that'll be dimmer than Hamal and Sheraton, but bright enough that any binoculars are going to pick these up, no matter where you are, because binoculars are going to give you at least 3 or 4 magnitudes fainter than what you can see naked eye. So as long as you can see those two stars naked eye, you'll be able to see Eta Piscium, no problem. So continue on in this direction, and this is where you kind of have to trust yourself that you're going in the exact same direction, because we're going to be going where there really isn't a whole lot. Now we're into a seventh magnitude star here when we put Eta right at the edge of our field of view, and we still have a little ways to go before we get to the next one. So we're going to go about a field of view and a half to get to our next point where we really are going to bring in another star. This is this next one that we're going to have come in, and as you can see, Eta's way over here. And now this star is Epsilon Piscium. It's also a fourth magnitude star. But conveniently for us, Uranus is now in the field of view. So whether you're using binoculars or a magnified finder scope on your telescope, once you have this star in here, you've got Uranus in your field of view. You can then center that easily. Now, the nice thing about Uranus, we drop our view down just slightly to see that, is that it's a sixth magnitude object. So even though we're passing some of these sixth magnitude stars along the way, remember that if you're seeing third or even 3.5 magnitude stars naked eye, then you'll be able to see Uranus in binoculars. Because sixth magnitude is only a couple magnitudes fainter than that. So it may be difficult to see, but you can pick it off because you're going to have this triangle of stars here. We've got Epsilon at 4.2 magnitude, a fifth magnitude star, and then another fifth magnitude star, and Uranus is right in between those three, and you'll see there's actually this other little smaller triangle off to the one side. So in the larger triangle, that is where Uranus is, and what we'll do is look at the date as we go forward in time, because that will change over time, because as Earth moves and as Uranus moves, where its position is with the stars will change. But you can see at least for the next week or so, it's going to be in that larger triangle, and then it'll go over top of the smaller one as we go into November. So easily for a month and a half, you're going to be able to find Uranus without any problem just by using binoculars. And then if you do find it with a magnified finder on your telescope, do bump up the magnification, because what you'll start to see is this pale blue color, kind of like my shirt. And the nice thing about that, in this particular area right now, if we zoom in, we'll notice that most of the stars in the area are either A-class stars or K-class stars. So, F-class stars even. So all we're really going to have is white and maybe yellowish tinged stars for the most part. These K-class ones will be yellowish somewhat. So all these brighter ones in the area are going to give a color contrast to Uranus, which will definitely have a pale blue to it, and it also won't twinkle, because it will have kind of that steady look to it. And when you look at the size of Uranus, you can actually see a disk there. It's really, really small, but at 3.3 arc minutes, the apparent diameter is actually 3.7 arc seconds, which is as small. 3.0 arc minutes would be really big. 3.0 arc seconds, that's small, a little smaller than the smallest you'd see Mars at, but Mars gets nearly that small, so we can't actually see a disk. Try to bump up the magnification as much as you can, 120, 150, 200, 250 times, you'll see more of that disk. There's no real features to see. It's a pretty pale, boring blue disk, but you're seeing the seventh planet in the solar system, which is a pretty cool thing. Don't forget to look for the planets early in the morning over in the eastern sky. If you get up early before dawn, those are still moving in all kinds of great configurations, with Venus being really bright and Jupiter being bright. And also, if you're in the same region looking for Uranus, don't forget we also looked at for Neptune several weeks back, and we can see that as well. So you can look for the two outer gas giants while you're looking in the evening sky, at least. And also on Eyes in the Sky, don't forget that there's lots of more information, not just about how to find things in the sky, but there's telescope basics there, there's stargazing basics, and I have a lot of other information about how to learn about telescopes and make things and even find other stuff. So do check out eyesinthesky.com, and that's all for this week. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.